Can you all see me from where you are?
Yes.
Okay. I've been doing this little trick for some of you in your hands, and I think it's there's something that magicians say, that the best magic happens in your hands, or happens in their hands. The other thing magicians say is that all magic occurs in their minds. And those two statements are really important for me. And I think a lot of my work is trying to work out how those two things fit together, and perhaps what the difference is sometimes and how they're similar sometimes. But this is the first trick I ever learned. And I thought it was my dad. That's my dad, coming second in a hot pants competition. The guy with the moustache came first. And my plan, by the way, we've got about an hour and a half. My plan was to talk for about half an hour about what I do. But that'll involve me getting you to do little things. And then we'll have an hour for me to teach you some stuff. And my plan was to teach you how to mind read, essentially. So for about half an hour, I'm just gonna bibble. I made a really big presentation, not knowing exactly who you were and, you know, exactly what kind of things we'd be doing with the rest of the day. So what I have here is a too big presentation that I'll be skipping back and forth through. I'm just telling you that so it doesn't look like I've planned badly. So I thought my dad taught me this trick. I really remember him teaching me it, and I ask him and he says he'd never seen it before. And I mean, he's drunk most of the time, so it's hard to tell. But he claims he never knew this trick, and maybe it was something off the TV. And then I went to my Auntie Reenie's funeral fairly recently, and my cousin said, I saw your talk online. Because I talked about this at a TEDx talk. And my cousin said it was my dad. It was my Uncle Bill did it. And he remembers me leaping, and Uncle Bill was quite muscular, and me dangling off his arm, going, I know how you're doing that, but I had to see. You know, I had to see, and he wouldn't let me see. This is why I became a magician. And I think the whole thing, everything I do, is about trying to work out why, when he did this trick, I felt like I'd been gently punched. Yeah? I'm not that interested in the psychology in some ways. The psychology is just, you know, how do you get the trick to work? I'm interested in the physical feeling that we have when we experience the impossible. When we have that moment where it feels like the world's turned upside down. And what's the physiology behind that? You know, why do we get that very physical feeling? And why do some people like it and some people really hate it? You know, some people just, if you do a good magic trick on them, they leap and they go, and they hate you. They really hate. And I've had people just go to punch me when I've done something. And then they've gone, oh, sorry. I don't know why. There's a kind of defense mechanism against. Anyway, this is a very simple trick. I'm going to count. If you count along with me in your heads, don't count aloud, and watch the balls. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Did that work? That worked.
It worked.
Exact time. Because you saw it before.
Yeah, I saw it before. It worked the same.
Right. Now, and what does it feel like when it happens?
Delightful.
It feels delightful.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, some people, did anybody not like it?
Well, I don't think I felt like it's delightful. It feels sort of like confounded. It's not entirely pleasant feeling.
Mm-hmm.
It's unpleasant. It's not entirely pleasant.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. My dad's got a friend, a couple who are, she's Catholic. And for years and years and years, he loves magic. She leaves the room. Right? And I always understood that it was because she was Catholic and she believes that the cards are like fortune-telling and evil. Right? And I thought that for perhaps 20 years, I believed this to be true. And then one time with my dad and his mate, and I went, yeah, because Mary doesn't really like the thing. And he went, nah, that's bollocks. She just doesn't like not knowing. She pretends that it's her Catholic beliefs, but she just doesn't like it. But there's a physical feeling.
And so
why do we gasp? Why do we get that very physical thing when we see an impossibility?
Yeah. For me, I think, because now that you said that, I totally connect with that feeling. Like, it's nice, but there's a part of me that's annoyed because I know it's a trick, and I don't know how to do it, and obviously you do it twice, and I still know
just makes it worse.
I don't know how to do it. So it's kind of less fun the second time.
Shall I do it again?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, no, I shall I do it again? Shall I do it really slowly?
Yes. But I suppose it's something here about... I don't ever not want to believe in Father Christmas.
So I'm not Father Christmas.
We get to a stage where I'd rather keep the corridor of magic open than have it slowed down to buy into something else that I might not. But that's why I think that's really a really interesting place because I'd rather keep believing in Father Christmas because it's just more fun.
So here's the thing: Penn and Teller have a beautiful trick where they show a Perspex box that's sealed, completely sealed, and the audience members up to look at it, right? And they go, we can't open it, it's sealed. And then they say, if you close your eyes for just 3 seconds and open them, Teller, the little one from Penn and Teller, he'll be inside this box, right? And you won't know how he got there, and you will experience a moment of magic. Or you can keep your eyes open, and you will see how it's done. Mm-hmm. Up to you. If you keep your eyes open, though, ask yourself this question: why did you come to see a magic show? Isn't that a great question? Yeah. I think that's especially for me being a magician. I was like, what would I do? I'd buy 2 tickets and go the next night, obviously. but I want that first feeling first.
Yeah.
And there are tricks that I've seen that I could know the answer to that I haven't asked.
I've seen the same kind of a scene, a show where it was a magician show, but it was also shows it was both, and there was a moment where he said, for you who want to see how this trick was done,
right, who did
keep
that?
Your eyes open. Oh, maybe it comes to me. It was
right.
In Belfast, I saw the guy, but I think he was Scottish.
Oh.
Kind of a young guy.
If you remember, tell, because I think it's a really interesting tactic.
Yeah, because you could see, and I chose my eyes.
There's another magician, John Allen, who does a lovely thing where he has a card signed, and then the card vanishes. And he brings out an envelope that's sealed. Mm-hmm. And he says, the card's in there, but here's what impossibly, the card is in that envelope. But what I'm going to suggest, you can open it if you like and have a look, but you will have destroyed an impossible object. Or you could take it home and not look.
Oh.
And it's a just beautiful tactic, isn't it? So, slowly. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. So I added something then by going really slowly, which is just a dickish joke,
right?
To annoy you slightly, and then to go really fast to annoy you more, right? So I referred to this as misdirection by annoyance. Right? What I'm doing is engaging a particular emotion, and when you're feeling that emotion, you can't pay attention. Annoyed people can't pay attention. People who laugh, when you're laughing, you can't pay attention to things. So some very good comedy magicians, they will make jokes at really good times.
Yes.
To distract, because if you're going, oh.
Like
I can't see what happened. Oh, what? Where's he gone?
Yeah.
but you have to be careful, because if you do it too much, then people will know they've been misdirected, and then it hasn't worked. So just a gentle little laugh causes people to go inside themselves slightly, and diffuse the attention. And that's better. That's more subtle. If you see what I mean.
Oh my god.
Killing the rainbow. What did Shelley said? We murder to dissect. So, I've been doing what I call research magic. That's me in a recording studio. I was talking to somebody about this, recording the sound of car shuffles and things. So, I say 20 years because I spent my teens, I was thrown out of school, spent my teens until I was about 25 performing as either doing magic or as a performance poet. Then at the age of 25, I went to uni and did cell biology and worked in cancer research. Because stuff happened and I just went, I'm sick of poetry, it annoys me. And so I completely walked away from it and became a scientist. But I paid my way through uni doing a mixture of performing magic, didn't get much money for performance poetry. You still don't, I don't think. And doing tarot readings on the phone. I used to do the 8 o'clock at night till 2 a.m. phone tarot. I have no belief that tarot is in any way supernatural. Right? I don't think there's any mystic powers attached to tarot decks. I think tarot decks are beautiful, beautiful things. I think the early Marseille decks are like works of art. But 2 years of 8 o'clock at night till 2 a.m, phone tarot. No men. Not a single phone call from a man in 2 years. One question, pretty much. Variations on one question. Does he love me? No drunk people. Slightly tipsy sometimes, but even 2 a.m, not drunk. Anyway.
Just as a slight side note for that, for 10 seconds, as my friend has just worked with Samaritans for 3 years and just still hardly got any phone calls from any men either.
Right. Really? Wow.
That's true. And there's a separate thing there that is Samaritans, and they're doing a separate launch specifically for men because men don't speak and it's the highest suicide.
Yeah.
But
it was an interesting mix of people doing, because we had like fundamentalist believers, if you like, people who believe that what the cards say is true, right? And so I remember overhearing somebody saying, so you're meeting this guy tomorrow night and you've never met him before and you don't know any of his friends and your friends don't know his friends and nobody knows where you're going and it's to a part of Manchester where you've never been before. Oh, well, the cards say he's perfectly trustworthy, have a great time. And I was like, whoa, hang on. And he's like, what do you mean? Don't you believe? Right? And then there were people like me who just saw it as a kind of having a supporting chat. And the number of times I said the line, it's not about him, it's about you. And the line, you're stronger than you think you are. So it's like that over and over and over and over. But then they changed, after 2 years, they changed the way you were paid. I used to be paid by the hour, whether I was on the phone or not. Then they changed to being paid by how long you kept them on the phone.
Oh.
And I couldn't do that. I don't have many morals.
Yeah.
But that was too much. I couldn't do that one. But there was one guy who didn't believe and was a dick. And he used to say things like, oh, we've got to the point now where we've gone as far with cards as I think we can in this session. Have you had any crystal work done? Because we have a crystal room here. A crystal room. This is like in a centre of Manchester in the old rag trade district. And you'd go, well, I'll go to the crystal room, I'll just put you on hold. And then you'd just have a cigarette. And then you go, emeralds are really strong in your life. Yeah. And I thought that was wrong as well, see? Because you're just, anyway. So I started working in about 93. I realised I wasn't really cut out for lab research. Because I didn't have the patience. And I got interested in multimedia and interactive CD-ROMs and all that kind of stuff. So I taught myself how to program something called Director, some called Lingo at the time. And this guy, who was one of the early writers on computer interaction, Tog, was an amateur magician. And he said, perhaps no field other than magic is tied so closely to the field of graphical interface design. Because this, you know, it's not a waste paper bin. It's not. It's It's not really a waste paper bin. Those things aren't files. Those things aren't folders. Yeah? It's an illusion. It was originally called the graphical interface illusion. Yeah? And he suggested three things to become better at designing software. That we should study magicians, we should read books of magic, and we should learn to do some magic tricks. And I went, brilliant, I'm gonna do that, right? So I spent about 10 years working in interactive television, working for a company called Oyster Partners, who were a big internet consultancy, and any chance I got, I would try to apply magic to designing those things. And I used to bang on about it, and I was a judge on the BAFTA Interactive Awards 2000 and 2001, those 2 years. And somebody listened and recommended me for a Nesta fellowship. So in 2002, Nesta gave me a chunk of money to pursue this question, how do you apply magic to other fields? And so I quit what I was doing, and that's what I've done ever since, pretty much. I was a 0.5 senior lecturer in digital media design in Huddersfield for a number of years, but I ended up quitting that because I just wanted to do this all the time. So that's my background. But things like this were important. The Death and Resurrection Show, which is a book by an academic from Liverpool. His claim is this: all entertainment and pretty much all the kind of performing art forms come from shamanic practice. And he draws a line from the shaman to the fools, the medieval fools, to the wandering magicians of the 17th century, to the stage magicians of the 19th century, to David Bowie. Right? And he draws that line. And I think he overplays it, but I think he's got a point. Right? But of course I would, in some ways, because... So there are some good books about magic and how it relates to all these things. There aren't that many books on how magic fits into other art forms, I don't think. I'm a co-editor of the Journal of Performance Magic. So if any of you are academics and you want to write about anything to do with magic in any way, we're interested in those kinds of things. But magic is an old art form. Interactive narrative is proper old. So this is apparently two people doing cups and balls. They may be making bread, but it has been interpreted as people doing magic. And so there was this thing in the late 90s where people started talking about interactive narrative all the time, and I kept going, this isn't new. Magicians have done these things. You know, branch narratives and, you know, multiple endings. Yeah, magician, we call it multiple outs. We've been doing that for a long time. Yeah. I was on a panel to do with kind of interactive theatre, and I was late. The train was like 3 hours delayed, so I had to come in and people had started talking. And I went, what are you talking about? And then we're talking about this new problem of when you get somebody from the audience on the stage and you get them to do stuff. And it's brand new in theatre. And what happens if they don't do what they're asked? And I was like, magicians have been getting people on stage for at least 150 years. And we have ways of, how do you choose? Who do you choose from the audience and how? Right? And, you know, like choosing you earlier was, you know, that was a genuine piece of mind reading that I want to teach you. You know, but if I'd failed, I was after somebody who would respond physically. So often, because the kind of magic I do, I need people who respond very physically on stage. So I have ways of approaching that. And it being a kind of storytelling art. I don't know why that picture's in there. That's a bunch of storytellers. Crick-crack club people in there. You might not be able to make their faces out. That's me really fucking with them. I'm doing this thing. I'm pretending to teach them a magic trick, but I'm actually not. So I'm just messing with them. So they're going, I can't get it to work. And I'm going, no, you nearly had it, do it like this. And then I told them what I was doing, and they were really... You're not allowed to do a magic trick on somebody while you're pretending to teach them how to do a magic trick. That was like, that's too much for them. So storytelling is very important to me. This blew my mind, the Beyond the Border International Storytelling Festival, which is every 2 years now. It used to be every year. And I went there to do a performance and to run a session on magic and storytelling, how you link the two. I think it's very difficult to link storytelling to magic. It's very, very hard to get it right. But I saw amazingly magical performers who weren't doing any tricks. And I came back and slagged off all my magician mates. You know, and what it really made me realize is that the world of magic performers, because we all hang out together and we're quite insular, and we all think we own the word magic, you know, and we don't. So loads of people do magical things. So a sideshow is stuff that I do quite a lot of. That thing there, the strange thing, that was an attempt to deal with the problem of mobile internet. And because sideshows are dying, right? Because you put your signs up that say £5 to see these 10 curious objects, a Fiji mermaid. Yeah. And people will go, Fiji mermaid, what's that? Yeah, yeah. Oh, it's one of those. £5, I've seen one. Right? So we've broken curiosity in that way. So the thing about the strange thing is I pretend not to know what it is, right? And there are no pictures of it allowed on the internet. It has, the strange thing has an internet absence, right? So it has a Facebook thing where I just post loads of pictures of strange things that aren't the strange thing, right? Other strange things, yeah. And some weird things are allowed and odd things are allowed as well. A strange thing. I really play with this whole thing of what is strange, and really that's a performance. So I'm standing there trying to get people to pay me 50p to look at the strange thing, right? And what I'm selling isn't the strange thing. I'm selling the faces of the last person who looked, right? So once I get one person to look, and it's usually a kid, because at the start of the day, normally somebody comes over and says, you know, it's two parents, and they go, how much just for the kid? Like, you're fucking tight, it's only 50p. And they go, how much for just the kid? And I go, well, you know, 50p, but you have to wait there. And then I go, oh, it's good, because we can watch their face, look. And then the kid will go, the kid hears that. I say it loud enough so the kid will hear, because kids are show-offs. And the kid now knows that they're on stage, and they will show off. And they'll go behind and they'll go, or they'll go, you know, they'll make some ridiculous face. And the parents go, what is it? And the kid cannot explain. Because the strange thing is such that you can't explain what it is. You just can't. Right? So then the parents have to look. They're like, I can't not know. Like, I now have to look. And so long as there's somebody else looking, I can be going, how strange was it? I've got this question that always works. I go, on a scale of 1 to 10, how strange was it? And if I ask people on a scale of 1 to 10, how strange was it? Nobody ever gives me a number. On a scale of 1 to 10, how strange was it? And they'll go, ooh, very strange. So then I can go on a scale of 1 to 10, very strange. And then of course that's strange. And if I go, how strange was it? People will go, oh, really odd. And I go, no, the odd thing ran away. That's the strange thing. So it's, you know, it's an interactive performance, is what it is. And you can, although it's only 50p, in a good long day, you can get 1,000 people in and out. Right? And so this is called a grind show. Grind shows are shows where I don't want them to stay too long in there. I want them to get out. So there's no signage, nothing for them to stay there too long with. I want them to go in, look and fuck off. And so I can get the next people in. Yeah. And I had to get past mirrors. Some people thought that, this was like, I'd done it 3 times and it didn't work that well. And somebody went, oh, it's just going to be a mirror, isn't it? And I was like, yeah. People think it's a gag. They're going to see their own face and it's a mirror. So now I have to tell people it's not a mirror. So what I do is, I'm there saying, come, possibly the strangest thing you've ever seen in your life, and it's not a mirror, madam. So now it's a gag, right? And I do that to any teenage girls that walk past, I do that gag to them, and they come in. They will come in and have a look, right? Because they're like, ooh, cheeky. And now it's got past that little bit of, Englishness, because we're all too scared to go and spend our money to go and see a strange thing.
Yeah.
Whereas in doing it in Spain, I had like the local baker made a thing in the shape of the strange thing, and one guy wouldn't let his pregnant wife see the strange thing because he was worried it would interfere with the unborn child. Anyway, see, I can spend too long on the strange thing. So curiosity is a very important thing for me. I do a lot of work with game designers. I was over in Helsinki last May working with something called Games Now. So I did a 3-day course on magic and game design, because game designers make worlds where you can die and be reborn. You know, they're like way better magicians than I am, right? And the way I used to approach that was I used to say, you're game designers, I'm a magician, let's look at the similarities. But now what I do is I say, you're game designers, I'm a game designer, it's just my games are different to yours. Because what's a performance of magic? What, you know, just that, is that a game? Or is it a story? The answer is yes to both of those things. And in the world of game designer, there's this big argument between ludology and narratology. And, you know, is a game a story or is a game a game? And how do we study it? So one thing that I was doing with them was teaching them how to read each other's minds as a form of game. So I'm going to do that with you in a bit. There's a project I'm working on at the moment, because magicians invented film, right? And I keep making these statements all the time. Magicians invented robots. Magicians invented day-glow clothing. Magicians invented caterpillar tracks, right? And I'm always claiming these things for magicians because we don't know this because magicians keep secrets, all right? But magicians invented film. If you don't believe me, read this book. Magicians made the first cameras. They made the first projectors, because film is a brilliant trick. It's not real. Yeah. So we're trying to, I'm working with Mark Cosgrove, who does all the film stuff in Watershed in Bristol, because we think this should be celebrated. So we're trying to get something going with the BFI to celebrate the way the magicians invented. I'm a magician in residence at the Pervasive Media Studio down in Bristol. There was was initially a 2-month thing, and I said towards the end, I said, so when does this finish? And they went, it doesn't really finish. I don't know if you know the Pervasive Media Studio people, but it's like one of us. Once you're kind of there, they're like family, but you can't leave. So I'm always doing bits of work with them. And film, this thing about film is one of them, how we invented it. We ran a season of films about magic. I got to perform one of, Orson Welles was a great magician. Huh? Before he was, apparently he made films and did some acting. But he was an awesome, awesome magician. There's a brilliant clip on YouTube of him producing a goose from nowhere and then hypnotizing the goose. Cool as fuck, awesome. And I got to perform one of his tricks, introducing the film. And we did some kind of immersive cinema stuff. We showed The Shining. And had lots of things going on, including me in a room pretending to be an academic who studies The Shining as a concept. Because The Shining was a real thing that psychics and fake psychics in the 1920s used to talk about, the people who would have The Shining. And Stephen King, who wrote the book, researched all of this, based the book on it. And then when Kubrick made the film, this is all lies. This is all lies. But I was pretending to be an academic, showing objects that were for testing if people had The Shining, and then things would start happening that would kind of throw us, and throw me. I would be a little bit confused by things. What? How is this? Hang on a minute. So people really liked it, and it's my best bit of feedback ever. Somebody wrote on the feedback form, what's your favorite bit? They wrote, because I was playing the Doctor, and they wrote, the Doctor, even better than the film The Shining. It's like, fuck you, Kubrick. Better than The Shining, me. Right? Which I was so proud of that. I was like, couldn't sleep, I was so proud. But we had, as you went into the film, you saw the twins in the corridor. And then as you came out of the film, they were axe murdered in the corridor. But this is the best feedback form I've ever seen. Somebody wrote, all work and no play makes Jack a dull boy, all over both sides of the feedback form. Just genius. So the mind reading web is a big thing for me, working with technology, because I realized that I'm going to be out of work fairly soon as a mind reader, because technology will do it. And then, you know, in 20 years' time, if I walk on stage and say, I can read your minds, everyone's going to go, we downloaded the app. Pfft, we can all do it. And that's not that far-fetched. So I did something for Future Fest a couple of years back based around this. What you're watching here is, this is a video that somebody's looking at. The system is looking at their brain and making a guess at what they're looking at based on having watched their brain look at lots of other videos in the past, right? And that's frighteningly, you're going to correct my technology.
No, I've got an actual story.
Do you want to say?
Yeah, I was just going to say, there's, they studied the cat's brain, they did the same thing, and what was weird was the cat was watching a film, but on the screen where it looked into the mind, the human face had a cat's face on it.
Fuck.
Yeah, so that's on YouTube as well, so it's like the cat sees like us as kind of like bigger cats or something.
Whoa! I love that. That is
it's
awesome.
It's the creepiest thing.
You think you're good to have the head of John Malkovich? You see everyone John Malkovich's face, probably, yeah.
Mouskovich. So this kind of technology is something I think I'm kind of up against, in a way. But also, magicians have a kind of arms race with technology. If I can get hold of some technology nobody knows about, I have maybe a year or two where I can use it. And then I have to demonstrate that I'm not using it to audiences. Mm-hmm. So at some point we will have e-ink, an electronic paper that's as thin as a playing card, that I can hold up a playing card and say, think of any card and tell me, and you'll say 10 of hearts and I'll do, and it'll say the 10 of hearts. And everyone will go, yeah, it's because you've just updated it wirelessly with your... And I'll have to somehow prove that I'm not using technology. So technology and magic have this tension that's interesting. So, people controlling other people's minds through the internet at a distance is technology we can do. This year's Future Fest, this is Brendan. Brendan Walker's a really nice chap. He's a thrill engineer, right? So he designs fairground rides. And this is a fairground ride that measures your brain activity and adjusts what's happening based on what you're thinking and feeling. Right, so personalized mind reading fairground rides are being made, and I'm going pick a card, you know? So how do I compete? What interested me with these two Victorian performers, Stuart Cumberland, when he was doing it, it was called Cumberlandism. And J. Randall Brown, who's a much better performer, who he taught Cumberlandism to. So Cumberlandism is a form of muscle reading, where you hold somebody's hand or arm, and you have them think, and what they're thinking, you can read through tiny little muscle movements. Mm-hmm. Yeah? And you use that to read their mind.
Tiny twitches, I was giving him the clues as to the letters, and then he would say the name of the first boyfriend, like think of your first boyfriend, and they'd
so this,
go Stuart or whatever.
So this is really interesting. So what we're talking about now is the ideomotor response. Mm-hmm. Right? Basically, if I ask you to think of something, a physical action, then your body will kind of do it. Your body will have a go at doing it, right? Speech is a very interesting aspect of that. When you're listening to the human voice, you use a different part of your brain than when you're listening to any other sound, right? And when you listen to the human voice, you sub-vocalize what you're hearing. So as I'm talking to you now, your throats, all your kind of speech apparatus, is copying what I'm saying. Right? If you paralyze that in somebody, they can't understand what you're saying. Right? So your ability to understand what I'm saying is based in part on your ability to make the same shapes as me with your mouth and throat. Right? My argument is that this is true of everything. If I want to teach you something physical and I show you, let's say you'd never picked up a cup of coffee before, and I said, this is how you pick up a cup of coffee, right? And you drink it like this. Right? All of you now, on a subconscious level, are mimicking what I'm doing. Yeah? Because that's how we learn. It means that when you now have give it a go for real, your body's already had a go. Yeah? You see this loads when people watch sport. You know, if you're watching boxing, it's a whole bunch of people watching boxing and they're all doing this. Right? But even if they appear to be perfectly still, actually they're making very small movements. And it's those small movements that I work with. So to demonstrate this, we're going to do something quick with pendulums. So no expense. No expense, really.
Seriously, no expense.
Can you take one and pass it along, and then I'll be quicker, won't it? So if you've never played with a pendulum before, I've been doing lots of research into who's good at doing pendulums, who isn't, and I'll talk about that in a minute. But just hold it in a comfortable manner and focus all of your attention onto the tip of the pendulum, onto the paperclip. And as well as you can, imagine that it's moving. Oh. If you've got it moving in a straight line, imagine that straight line getting bigger and bigger and bigger. There we are, it's moving. So imagine it getting bigger, bigger. Can you see that? Okay. Yes, so focus on here, yeah. on the pendulum. Put all of your attention into that, and now as well as you can, imagine that it's moving. Just imagine it's moving. You'll get small movements at first, and then you can develop those movements. So this one here, you're not doing that deliberately, are you? Ah, what does deliberately mean? Does it feel like your hand's not moving?
I feel like my hand is not moving, but I feel like as I am looking, maybe something goes through my arm.
Right.
But my hand is not moving.
Try to make it move in a circle. So the way to get this going, if you're finding not much movement, is to get out of your own way. Don't think about why it's working. Don't think about what Deleuze and Guru, you know, would say about it. Just focus on it. If I do this and make it go bigger, yes, brilliant. Okay, you've all got that working to some degree. Do you feel like you're getting that moving?
Tiny bit,
yeah. So some people are really good at this, and in my performances, I often use pendulums early on to find people who are very good, and then I'll get them up and use them for other things because they've got big reactions. It's something you can train yourself to be better at. But what's happening is by you imagining the pendulum moving, your body is making those little movements to make it happen. Yeah? That and the spirits, of course. Right. So, the ancients used to think that this was a way of communicating with the gods. The Victorians thought this was a way of communicating with the dead. There was a dentist, a 19th century dentist, who realized that maybe there were some small muscle movements. So he put people's hands in blocks and discovered that if you put a block there, it doesn't work anymore. Right? So there's definitely little muscle movements happening. Yeah? Should we test? Do you want to know?
I don't know which one's which, though.
Oh, for very obvious reasons, that's a man, right? And that's a woman. It's the old symbolism, yeah. So it tends to be circles of women and lines of one, because men are the one and women are the other, aren't they? It's embedded with horrible gender stereotype, this stuff. The one place that pendulums are still used a lot is for sexing chickens, right across America. It's very hard to tell the sex of a baby chick. And the people who do it use pendulums, and they're very good. They're very good at knowing. And if you take the pendulums off them, they can't do it anymore. Yeah? And so this becomes a really interesting question. There's some research in Canada, year before last, where they took a group of people and had them answer a bunch of kind of quiz questions, yes or no answers. And then they said, of the questions that you got that you didn't know the answer to, right? They basically said, which questions did you not know the answer to, so you guessed, you had to guess at. And they looked at those questions, and the first group who answered using a computer, clicking yes or no, they scored 50% correct, which you would get by chance. Yeah. The second group scored 65% correct. They were using a Ouija board. Right. So either the Ouija board is letting us tap into some kind of inner knowledge, not the supernatural knowledge, but just we actually do know the answer, but we just need something to allow us to give our way, or the spirits are real and they like doing quiz questions, but they're only... But they're only 15% better than we are. It's a bit weird. I mean, I don't believe in spirits myself, but none of this denies the possibility of spirits, of course. Spirits could be involved. What do I know? I'm agnostic about the whole question of whether there are spirits. But they're doing more research, this group of academics, into what they call inner intel. They think there's this inner intelligence that we can tap into. Mm-hmm. Put your hand up if you toss a coin to when you're making decisions, even in a playful manner. Yeah? Some people have never tossed a coin. Keep your hand up if you do what the coin says. So when you toss a coin to go, what should I do? Should I stay in or watch telly or should I go to the pub? Heads. So this is why people do it. They toss a coin and then they go, I know how I feel now. Yeah. Right?
Yes, yes, yes.
So the question is, why can't we just ask ourselves how we feel? We don't do it very well.
Yeah.
And so tools, divinatory tools, I think historically are ways of interrogating our own feelings about things. I don't know if this will work because the blackboard's so fuzzy, but let's give it a go. Focus your eyes on that dot in the middle. No matter what I say, don't look away from that white dot. But focus your attention onto one of the big circles. Keep looking at the dot, but focus your attention onto one of the circles. Right? And you should find that circle is a different colour to the other two. Now shift your attention, keeping your eyes on the dot in the middle, shift your attention to a different circle. And you'll find that circle for most people, becomes darker. Right? So this is called the attentional spotlight or attentional zoom. What this proves is that it isn't where we're looking that determines exactly where our attention is. That attention is a psychological thing rather than a physiological thing. Yeah? Did that work for you?
Yeah.
I wasn't sure if it would work as a thing. So this understanding that if you pay your attention, you know, the first thing we did this morning where we got our feet on the four points, and what we were doing there very strongly was paying absolute attention to the feeling in our feet. So I'm going to try something with you that was something I started earlier. Get yourself into pairs. Stay where you are, but in as pairs, and decide who's going to be sender and who's going to be receiver.
Who's going to be what, sorry?
One of you initially is going to be sender. The other person's going to be receiver. It's not a sex thing. Okay, sender, your job is to send which finger you're thinking of to the receiver. So you're going to hold your hand up. Either way, doesn't really matter. First of all, relax your hand. And receiver, while their hand is relaxed and you're not thinking of any particular finger, just feel their fingers to get a kind of baseline, feeling what their fingers are like. Feel each. Without a choice. Feel each finger in turn. And don't be scared to like get in there and give their fingers a good wiggle. Yeah? To give his fingers a good wiggle. So that you can tell. Because you'll find that one of them is probably naturally stiffer than the other. And you want to know that before you try reading. Okay? Excellent. And like I say, it doesn't matter if it's this way up or this way or even this way around. Whichever way you start, carry on with that. Okay, now sender, in your mind, pick a finger. Right? Do that now, and I'm going to talk you through something that's going to help you to send it. Okay, so hold your hand up and think of a finger. Pick a finger, put all of your attention into that finger. Just like you were putting all of your attention into your feet earlier on. Put all of your attention into that finger. Now imagine, like you were doing with the pendulums, imagine that finger is growing bigger and stronger. Imagine like E.T. So imagine that it's crackling with energy. Imagine that you can hear the crackling of the energy coming off that finger. Imagine that you can smell the burning from the energy coming from that finger. And keep doing that, and receiver, touch their fingers again and look for the different finger. One of the fingers should feel different. Don't do thumbs, by the way. Thumbs are just a bit too different. So just the four fingers. Sorry if anybody was thinking of thumbs, I should have said that. Have a fiddle, sender, try to help them in the same way you tried to move the pendulum. So really focus your attention into that finger. And when you think you know, tell them which one you think it is.
Yeah. Sorry.
Did you get it?
Yeah.
We have win. We have a winner. We have two winners. This is how a real mind reader does it. Yeah, do it the other way around. You look like you're having your nails done. Going out tonight with Barry. Yeah, same thing the other way around. See if you can get it. Okay, so I just moved the camera for no reason at all. So try this when you're out and about with friends. It's a really good game to play in the pub. So you might want a couple of you want a couple of tips when you're doing it, right? Some people, who people who've got really good physical imaginations, a kind of embodied consciousness, kind of imaginations, you will get movement. The finger will start moving, right? So watch out for that, because it's a real giveaway. I did it to, what's his name, the guy who runs the watershed, Dick.
Dick.
And I might just think of a finger, and he went, oh! And I didn't even say, it was just obvious, his finger was going, so it's like, because he's one of those people that, like, he's on the surface, his emotions are there, that you can just reach and, you know. So that, but also if you're doing this in a kind of slightly competitive way in the pub, be aware that people generally don't think of the two end fingers, they think of the two middle fingers more. So that just increases your odds slightly, right? You can also have a look at where they're looking, but don't try and gauge where their eyes are looking, because that's really hard to do. Just draw a line from their nose, right? Draw a line from their nose, because you've asked them to put all of their attention on that finger, but and this works even better if you say, close your eyes so I can't see where you're looking.
No.
Right? Now they've got their eyes closed, people with their eyes closed think that you can't see either. Right? So they're like this. You never work out which one I'm thinking of. So their focus goes in, and it teaches you how to be aware of other people's focus, where their focus really is, where their attention really is. So I'm going to just talk about a couple of other things, and then I'm going to show you a kind of next step of this muscle reading thing. My question was, given that when I started learning this, I wasn't that good, right? And what this guy, J. Randall Brown, used to do, he used to say, in this envelope I have the money I'm being paid for this performance this evening. Can you take this? I'm going to be blindfolded behind with people watching. Can you hide this in the audience? Yeah. Then he would say, can you stand up a second? Just here, focus this way, relax your arm. Excellent. And he would say, don't lead me there, but imagine you're leading me to where the envelope is. If you think we should go this way, imagine we're going this way. Mm-hmm. If you think we should go that way, imagine we're going that way. And then he would feel the arm in the same way you're doing with the fingers, mm-hmm. and he would find the envelope. Mm-hmm. He failed once. He claimed he had a cold. I think he failed deliberately because it was getting boring. Yeah. If you go and see somebody who's never failed to find the envelope, it's dull. But if one time he lost and he gave away that £1,000, now there's danger. And so that actual thing I'm going to have you have a go of in a minute, that serious muscle reading. Can technology do this? Because it seemed to be a perfect thing that we could do with accelerometers and magnetometers. We can attach things to people's bodies and have them sense those little movements. So can we feel idiomotor responses? Right? Again, going back to the first thing we did today, where this lean forward, lean to find your balance. If you put motion sensors on somebody, have them stand, and have them imagine an event that's going to happen in the future, their bodies lean forwards. If you have them imagine something that happened in the past, their bodies lean backwards. Because we imagine the future being that way and the past being that way, at least in this culture. Most cultures do. Mixed tech is, I think, there's only two languages in the world that do it the other way around, where the future's back there. And for good reason, because we can't see the future, so it must be behind us. What I did in the 2 months when I started as magician in residence at Pervasive Media Studio, this was a collaboration between Pervasive Media Studio and University of Bristol's Computer Science Department. So they put me with a couple of people there, and I said, this is what I want. I want a device that can read some muscle movements. Yeah. And we messed around. The best success we had was with these XBMU chips, because they have really good accelerometers in them. So we strapped one of these onto somebody's hand, and we said, either imagine that you're patting a dog or you're flushing a toilet. Yeah. Don't really do that, or that. Just imagine you are. Yeah? They're nice because they're wireless. So we were sending the data straight to a computer. And within about a week or so, we were getting 90, 92, 93% accuracy reading whether people were thinking about patting dogs or flushing toilets. Yeah? But these, at the time, were about 200 quid. They've got cheaper now. We've kind of compressed that down. So I'll show you in a second how that works. So I made IdioBird. IdioBird is a mind-reading bird that basically does two things. Well, what does one thing? It makes noises. It either goes bing for a yes, or it goes for a no. And it's really loud, because I wanted this to play in audiences. This is IdioBird being able to tell which object somebody is thinking of on a table of objects. Yeah. So I'm basically asking the bird handler, and the reason that she is doing it is because I got the whole audience to do pendulums. I picked four people who were good at pendulums. I'd had them do something else. And so she's the person who I've already put them through training to get them doing this good physical imagining. Yeah.
Why are some people better at just moan?
So IdioBird was on BBC News, and on they felt that they had to do this weird, IdioBird doesn't project images above its head. Like that, BBC added that. And it was on BBC Click, Christmas special. So we got interested in bottle pendulums. So if this thing with the pendulum moving with your mind, if you put a pendulum in a bottle, put it on the table, put your hands on the table and imagine it moving, it'll move. Yeah? So long as the table wobbles slightly, by which I mean a table. Yeah. I've never found a table that doesn't have some wobble in it. Yeah. If you put four pendulums of different lengths on the table, you can make one of them move just by focusing on that one, so long as they're not harmonic with each other. Yeah. So this in itself is really quite spooky, and it's something that you can't quite see that, but this is an old spirit device with a bell in it that would be used to pretend that somebody had psychic powers. This at the back has a secret bit of string that would go down to the psychic's foot, that you would ding it. Yeah? But you could still, by getting people to put their hands on the table, you could get it to move. So you could use it both in a real way and in a fake way. So what we did was we dangled a massive magnet over a Hall effect sensor that measures change in magnetism, so change in Gauss, going through an Arduino and a force-sensitive resistor on one end, and we made the stupidest game ever. The game is to make the pendulum wobble as much as you can using as little force as you can. So we're dividing the swing by the push. And then we call that idiomotor quotient. So this is trying to measure how good people are at making pendulums swing, and so we can ask that question you asked, why? Why are some people better? Yeah. It's a bit like when you push somebody on a swing. If you push when the swing is coming towards you, that's just a waste of energy. If you push too hard, the chain buckles and you're wasting energy. But if you push just right, so if you just resonate just right, then you'll be using very little force, but the swing will be big. Right? So the game is really wobble the table with your finger. So it's a very dumb game. But if you put people in front of it, they will get beamed into it. It's quite a focusing, mindful kind of game. Your body really beams into it. So I sat down and played it, and I got 15. 15 what? We didn't even know. We called them Nolans, because what the fuck are they? It's like changing Gauss over changing force-ish. I got 15. Pete Bennett, who helped make this, sat down, he's got 27. But every time I did it, I scored 15, so I thought he was broke. And then he scores 27. We tested lots of other people. this guy Ben, who's a real kind of maths head, came over and he watched us and he went, after about 20 minutes of watching, he went, right, I've sussed it. Got it. He sat down and scored 3. Right? And he can't get off above 3. I can't really move from 15 very well. Right? So we realized that this was a kind of a way of testing whether people were good or not. So we packaged it into what we call Ouija Bird, which is a combination of a kind of a Ouija board. It's kind of a scientific device. It's kind of a stage prop. It's kind of a game. It's got like flashing lights and LEDs and things so the audience can see what's going on. And I can have people do a head-to-head, not at the same time, but you can play from either side so people don't have to get up and move around and kind of stuff. What we find is we think that Pete is good at it because he's a musician. He plays trombone. We find that musicians, especially musicians who play fretless instruments, are already used to resonating with objects in the world. Yeah. People who live their lives very much up in their heads in a certain way really struggle. They're also the same people, of course, who can't do any of these pendulum and idiomotor things. Yeah. If you spend your focus, your attention, stopping your hand moving, yeah, it's not going to move. Yeah? If you deliberately move your hand, then you score low on my device because it knows you're that's too much force. Right? But to make it move a lot with no visible movement of my hand, yeah? Mm-hmm. So that's good, if you see what I mean. That's what we're calling good. Yeah? And I suggest, because of what you just said, that you were going, but I was putting lots of attention to make sure that didn't move. That's why it wasn't moving. So you've got to allow it to move, but not make it move deliberately, but also not get in its way. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah.
In terms of actors, we did a piece, and there was a chorus of women in the show who had to, their task was to get audiences to move without touching them. And so Sylvia and Hayley were both involved in that piece. And this is really interesting in that context, isn't it? Like this idea of like, okay, you cannot, don't grab audience.
Yes.
Be cool.
Yeah, yeah.
Us, do not, you know. And actually try not to touch them, but move them.
Yeah.
So we spent we did that show for 7 years.
Yeah.
And I spent a lot of time developing actor training, trying to get people. And you honestly, there were just some women, they just had it.
Yeah, yeah.
But other women, I can't teach you how to do this.
Yeah.
I don't know how to teach you it. It just seems to be really innate.
Yeah.
And we broke it down whether it was like, you know, a great trick that Adrian Jackson showed me from forum theatre, in forum theatre.
Right.
A really simple one, where he just went, he would look for a volunteer, you know what forum theatre is, right? Where they get people to come up, but sometimes it's a bit tricky. And he go, okay, any volunteers? And of course he's using that sixth sense to look at who could be open and who's not, and that's a bit of magic right there, isn't it? And it's like, and he'll pick on someone, he'll be like, okay, thank you very much. And he won't touch them, but he'll turn his back and start walking off.
Yep.
And then she's just compelled to move after them. And it's all that kind of motor neuron copying. What you say about copying.
Yeah.
All of that behavior is so brilliant.
The other thing is... the other thing is... First time I introduce people to pendulums, right? If there's a little bit of misunderstanding, then somebody's going to struggle. So my thing is to think of it all as being my fault, right? So if somebody just really hasn't paid attention and misses something, that's my fault. It's absolutely my fault, right? So if when I'm saying your hand's going to stay perfectly still, you interpret that to mean keep your hand perfectly still and then the pendulum doesn't move. That's me not being clear enough. Yeah. And so when I say that people can't shift their values, people can, so long as they're kind of clearly inducted into the idea. Yeah? Does that make sense? Plus, When I'm saying things like, we find that people who ride horses and act and dance and things tend to be good, that doesn't mean you have to be, right? And it's also slightly, this isn't hard science, right? Even though we've tried to put it through some rigor, because the guys at Bristol Uni have been writing papers about this stuff, right? But it's still, for me, a theatrical thing, right? And one of the things I do all the time is lie to audiences, because I'm a magician, right? So if I can get more people getting pendulums to work by telling them that it's sexy, I will, yeah? Because I want them moving those pendulums. So that's what I'm after. You know, these are oracular devices. These kinds of things, like this is scapulomancy. When you're hunting elk, if you've had a bad year, you haven't caught many elk, right? You'll take an elk scapula and throw it in the fire and look at the cracking that happens and interpret that as potential elk hunting routes to go on, right? Not necessarily that this is the gods telling you where the elk is, but this is a way of being creative. In the same way you might buy Eno's deck of cards. Yeah? This is just a way of opening your mind to thinking in a different way about where those elk might be to kill them. So I'm as influenced by that and things like this. Carbala. This is a 1970s board game. Remember that Ouija boards were initially a board game. They were designed as a game. So this, it has a kind of half a ball underneath, and you put your fingers on it, and you wobble it, and a little marble goes round and round and round and round. And when it stops, the two of you do it together, and when it stops by a letter, and then you write those letters down, and it communicates with you. And this eye follows you around, follows the marble round. It's called the all-seeing eye of Carbala, and it's green. It's green plastic, and it glows in the dark. This is the thing is, they go for about $120, but then shipping is always massive from Canada. So, but see, things like this I love.
So, a cousin in Canada.
Yes.
Talk to me later.
Excellent. So I'd show you this video. So this is what happens when we then flatten it down into apps. So this is mixing three sounds. I've got some of these on this phone, so if you want to play with it.
We won't have time to do the other thing I was thinking I'd try and fit in, but I'll mention it. What I was saying before about all this and these apps. The exercise we did this morning where we had to draw something, right? And then you do a drawing, trying to read the tension and relaxation of their hand. Yeah? And within 10 minutes, we had people going, I don't know how I just did that. And one woman would draw like a candy wrapper, you know, on the sides. And the other woman would just duplicate this perfectly without having seen the drawing, without them exchanging it. Basically, if I stand here and I think, like, I want you to go that way,
right.
So then you hold my hand,
yes.
And I'm imagining that I'm leading you one way.
Right. Yeah. And
right.
I'll interpret that.
Can you interpret
that? Try to interpret it.
Yeah. And feel free to kind of hold my arm around. Does that feel like I'm deliberately leaving?
Doesn't feel like that.
Because to me, it doesn't feel like I'm leaving you. It feels like I'm just thinking, go that way.
Yeah. So the following.
I'm just. Yeah.
Which one? Okay.
Okay.
Something in me wants to be this, and be like, no, we don't.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
They don't want to do that. Yeah. It's hard to.
There we go.
Yep.
But does this person have to be